towards the Christmases.
Christmas is fast approaching. And cabinet met yesterday. And coming out of that cabinet meeting, the head of the presidential secretary and secretary to the cabinet, Dr. Roger Luncheon, will bring us highlights from a number of matters cabinet wish to bring to our attention, to you, the media, after which we will open up for questions, first in its opening presentation, and then subsequently on any other topical matter. I'll hand you over to Dr. Roger Luncheon.
Thank you, Swami, and good morning again, ladies and gentlemen of the media. Cabinet met yesterday on the 9th of December 2014, and arising from that cabinet meeting, these are the matters I would be bringing to yours and the public's attention. As usual, contracts for which cabinet granted its no objections to the awards, the Millennium Development Goals, Guyana Maternal Acceleration Framework. Number three, the Red Plus Reference Level, Guyana's proposal to the UNFCCC, and then cabinet snippets, sectoral ministries, annual reviews and oversight, diplomatic roundup. Allow me as usual to commence with the contracts for which cabinet granted its no awards, its no objection to the awards. The Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sport, and this is the track and field facility being constructed at Lilora on the west coast of Demerara in Region 3. And we're here in a phase 3 component that deals with the installation, of the lighting system, the installation of the lighting system for that facility. And that award, $45.25 million. $45.25 million for the construction and installation of the lighting system. And then we have the maritime sector. And this one has to do with the roads, the mining roads, the roads in the mining districts. And this here we are in Region 8, Mining District 6. And it's the road that is linking the Brian Sucre Junction to Blackwater Road, Brian Sucre Junction to Blackwater Road. And this contract is at the cost of $329.09 million. $329.09 million. This is a mining road in the mining district 6 in Region 8. Again, the mining sector, and this one deals with another road, and this is the road from Perica to Goshen. This is following the right bank of the Essequibo River, and the contract is for the provision of consultancy services for the engineering and supervision of that rule. Provision of consultancy services for the engineering, design, and the supervision on that rule. The three lots, Perica, Tualiki, Aliki, Tetaka, and then Itaka to Goshen. Aggregately, 304.48 million Guyana dollars. 304.48 million Guyana dollars. Consultancy services for the engineering, designs, and supervision for the Perica to Goshen Road. Then we are continuing in roads, the rehabilitation of Dr. Ministry. This is in Triumph on the East Coast, Region 4, and 39.38 million Guyana dollars. 39.38 million Guyana dollars. Public Works, still in roads, the rehabilitation and maintenance of roads in Region 1. Rehabilitation and maintenance of roads in Region 1. Aggregately, at a cost of $116.44 million, and this is in two lots. We have from Wanaima Bridge to Yarrapeter Landing, and then the rehabilitation, the laterite roads from Santa Rosa, Cabana, Aquero to Waramuri. $116.44 million aggregated. We continue roads, public work, the rehabilitation and construction of miscellaneous roads in Region 3, and the aggregate $36.80 million, And those roads include the Sideline Dam in North Virginogen, the main access road to the West Sideline Dam in the West Village on the West Coast. The security sector, an award of $103,000 Our mathematicians have calculated this at $21.4 million, and this is for the procurement of traditional combat boots for distribution to recruits. $103,000 That takes us somewhere to $21.4 million. Still in security, the procurement of weapons and ammunition for the Guyana Defense Force, $724,000 Again, our mathematicians advise this is about $150.9 million, $150.9 million for the procurement of arms and ammunition for the Guyana Defense Force. Yet again, insecurity, and this is the procurement of an additional two, and this here is the 38 feet, not the 36 feet as before. The metal shark patrol boats. The metal shark patrol boats and 800,000 US that our mathematicians again have calculated would take us into a ballpark figure of 166.7 million Guyana dollars. 166.7. Ladies and gentlemen, those wording contracts, cabinet no objections, were granted. Let's move on now to the other items on the agenda, and we'll start with the Millennium Development Goals, the MAP, the Maternal Acceleration Framework, and here, as the year 2014 draws to a close, the health minister, in his televised annual review of the health sector, should have little difficulty in highlighting Guyana's Millennium Development Goals, the maternal health development. He would be helped by the presentation at the launching of the Guyana Development Goals map that is scheduled to be held at the Fort Manston Lodge on Wednesday, December the 10th, actually today, at 10 o'clock. Actually, it might be over. The antenatal maternal hospitalization and labor, postpartum, all of these considerations have been addressed in Guyana throughout, and this has been with the collaboration of the PBPC administration and the donor community and the local civil society. The contributions have all contributed to the transformation of the practice of maternal health in Guyana to the levels that have been achieved as of today. Guyana's proposal to the UNFCCC, and this is the Red Plus reference level. Cabinet has endorsed the Guyana submission of its proposed reference level for Red Plus. As you know, Guyana is one of the Red Plus countries with large forests and with a uniquely extremely low deforestation rate. Our deforestation rate compared with global deforestation rates have been the study through reference levels of progress in countries in meeting global goals on the forest carbon sequestration, essentially carbon services provided by forests. Understandably, there is a compensatory mechanism for those countries whose forest carbon sequestration services warrant being compensated. And that has been the basis, the underpinning of the Guyana-Norway Agreement, the transformative LCDS, inaugurated in former President Jagdeo's term, 2006 to 2011, and specifically in 2009, has seen a reference level established in 2009 that over the years of the current Guyana-Norway Agreement has indeed allowed us to have a more mature grasp of how adequately Guyana is being compensated for its extremely low and persistently so rate of deforestation. This reference level that Guyana is proposing is indeed a contribution to the international, the global measure, which doesn't exist currently, but the UNFCCC is spearheading the move among Red Plus countries in arriving at a global measure. And of course, Guyana is maybe the only or one of the few places where there exists a commercial engagement between the government of Guyana and the Kingdom of Norway concerning this reference level and commercializing the forest services, carbon services provided by Red Plus countries. Our submission was made to the UNFCCC, and Cabinet was provided with an explanation by the Project Management Officer Head, Kapil, and the GFC Head, and they both provided yesterday, on Tuesday the 9th, the Cabinet with the guarantees, the assurances that the reference level proposals that Guyana has submitted indeed were those that were most likely to provide Guyana with the most financially feasible and sound outcome of any continuation of compensatory mechanisms for our low deforestation rate. So our submission to the UNFCCC would be revisable as we continue working on improving its presentation, and the UNFCCC would be conducting its review of Guyana's submission in 2015. Slippers. Cabinet at its meeting of Tuesday, the 9th of December 2014, concluded arrangements for the presentation of sector ministers annual sector reviews. These would be programs that are televised, where sector ministers would provide the listening public with the highlights of 2014 developments in their particular sectors. This does not, of course, replace the press encounter that ministers have traditionally hosted in their offices at the end of the year on perhaps a parallel activity, the developments in their sector. We would be starting this series of televised programming with the economic and productive sector, and I'm certain that the government services, information services, would provide the information about the schedules by which the ministers would be presenting their annual reviews to the Guyanese public. Diplomatic roundup. We had two agreements. One, Italy, where cabinet approved the grant of its agreement for the appointment of His Excellency Silvio Mignano, and he is the non-resident ambassador for the Italian Republic, and he would be resident in Caracas, Venezuela. The second one, Portugal. Again, cabinet granted this agreement to the appointment of His Excellency Fernando Manuel de Jesus Teles Fazendiero, and he would be the non-resident ambassador of the Portuguese Republic to the Republic of Guyana, and he also would be resident in the neighboring Venezuela, Caracas, Venezuela. Ladies and gentlemen, those are the matters I wanted to bring to your attention, coming from the cabinet meeting held on Tuesday, the 9th of December. Time is not against us this morning, and so the floor is indeed open without any restriction on sequencing on matters related to my opening statement and any other topical matters of your consideration. Thank you very much.
Madam Harris, the road for Rinkitic Ocean, is that the same Del Conte Road, because you're issuing a contract for engineering and designing and all of that.
Engineering design and supervision.
Wasn't that done when the first road was contemplated?
I cannot answer with any degree of accuracy. Yes, there is some overlap over this Del Conte Road, but whether it conforms this Goshen, Parika to Goshen, whether it does indeed conform to the planned then, 1960, Del Conte Road is not clear to me. I do know that this construction is predicated on new, starting from scratch, design work in the three lots that I mentioned, and the contract indeed captures the cost of supervision of the building, of the construction of the road. So it is design as well as supervision. Of course, you didn't ask me. The intention probably is to find an archery along the Essequibo River that amplifies the crossing you got at Surabana and Surimo crossing. You have another crossing that is expected somewhere about or just above Goshen that would allow traffic from all the west to actually end up on the east. And with the work that is being done on that $44 million US contract on the Green Hook to Perito to perhaps provide smooth sailing into Georgetown over either the old bridge or the new Demerara Harbor Bridge.
Also mentioned that it's about Demerara. Sir, can you see whether government has already acquired or had a need to acquire any lands along that route to facilitate the construction of the road?
That's a good question. It frequently has happened. As you might recall, the biggest example that I can remember during my time is on the Essequibo coast, where a considerable amount of acquisition of previously privately owned land was required for that Papalimia project. We're passing through, I suspect, farmlands and unimprovised lands, so they may very well be either to terminate leases for people who are farming in those areas. But other than I suspect there has to be some amount of acquisition, compulsory acquisition for public purposes, the volume and the specifics that you require, I couldn't provide at this time.
Yes, I'm Erica Williams from Ghana Times. I'm trying to find out, with elections around the corner, when will you guys be appointing a commissioner for the ERC?
Commissioner for the ERC? Well, that, I don't know what has happened historically, and I would just refer to the earlier example. The speaker convenes a meeting of the members who have already been confirmed as members of the ERC by the appointed committee of the National Assembly. They are yet to be sworn in, they have to be sworn in by the president. And then subsequently, those elected members at a meeting that I am advised, my recollection is at a meeting that is called to order by the Speaker of the National Assembly, they would then meet to elect a chairperson, and I suspect a deputy, and various other elected positions in the ERC. I say that to advise that all that is left outstanding is one, the swearing-in of the members who have all been identified and selected already. So the swearing-in of the members by the president, and subsequently the activity summoned by the clerk, by the speaker, where the election of office bearers will take place. Your question was when. I couldn't answer it. I hope, and I think I might have been asked this question previously, a couple of weeks ago. This obviously is an activity that awaits the president's availability to conclude.
Yes, confirmation for the current police commissioner. Is there any move to confirm?
What is this? The current police commissioner. Confirmation.
Well, I'm certain that you would. I'm not certain, but I do believe that there is an element of consensus. Either consensus that would be welcome or consensus that is required constitutionally for the appointment of a substantive commissioner. I'm not certain, I must admit. I'm not certain. But again, the role of the president in this confirmation is instructive. And were it exclusively a presidential responsibility, a presidential obligation, then this also is awaiting the president's convenience.
Just hold. You have two questions. Just hold with the third one. Is there anyone else? New? Well, Adam, you can go.
Adam, in you. Adam is old.
Sir, I would like to talk about the cable that was coming from Brazil. It was the government's cable. Mm-hmm. We have learned that that program has been scrapped. Could you, sir, say how much money was involved up to the point when the cable was scrapped and when we constructed those 54 towers?
I am not certain that it's unrelated matters, the towers and the cable, the towers indeed belong to a different project. This is the Huawei project, backbone project, from the east to the west. And the towers that support the network that was being established. What the cable was to do was to provide the bandwidth to that network, the Huawei network, as well as for other purposes, but essentially to provide the bandwidth, the connectivity that would allow the project, the Huawei project, to mature into its ideal proportions. The project, you said, was stopped. I am doubtful whether the definitiveness of your statement actually accords with the status right now. I, for one, am engaged in negotiations. You may want to call it that, but I have to be hesitant in these days of prolongation. But I'm involved with discussions with a local firm in collaboration with a neighboring country, another firm, to conclude the I suppose the right word would be rehabilitation of the existing cable that traverses the over 200 kilometers from its entry point in Letem to its termination here at Castellani in Georgetown. I don't know if that says that is not what you said, the project is terminated, the project is abandoned or collapsed. It is, what should I say, it is remediable. But in so saying, it is obvious I'm saying it is in need of being remedied. And perhaps this is what you really are interested in. The level and the costing, it costs a pretty penny. And this is the construction itself. I can be accurate, but I'm pretty certain that it exceeds over $1 billion. In moving, in excavating to the required standard and purchasing the length of cable to bring you from its entry point in Letem all the way to Georgetown. Subterranean, aerial, and other means of traversing the Ghana landscape. That project, at some time it probably was about 2011 and 2012, it was recognized that significant failures had occurred with contractors and they're meeting their obligations with supervisory and they're meeting their obligations in the development, in the unfolding of the project. And this is what the talks, the discussions, maybe the negotiations that I, for one, am a part of, to give some correction and some renovation, correction of the defects that have been documented as we move from Letem to Georgetown. So right now, that connectivity, that bandwidth is unavailable. Well, I would hate to say this publicly, but I suppose the Brazilians may very well have told you, and Adam asked me, would the Brazilians tell you? Well, we haven't paid them, but we are, how should I put it? We do have a contract to purchase bandwidth. And the bandwidth, how should I say, the mechanism for accessing the bandwidth hasn't kicked in. So on that basis, I think the Brazilians have been understanding because they know they haven't provided. But we do indeed have run up some $76,000 I think, a year in cost for purchase of bandwidth.
Okay, so Adam, you'll have to take to correct that misleading headline in the papers today. Yes.
In keeping with the specifications of these results that have been granted,
well, I'm not certain if you're asking me as a definitive outcome or you're asking me about government's interventions if I assume you're being broad-based and you're asking about government interventions, I believe legal actions have been filed against contractors and supervisory firms for their non-compliance with contractual obligations. Whether it has gotten to the point of a ruling and government collecting, in essence, these forms have been penalized, I would have known how that occurred, and I don't believe it has. Anyone? No, no, what I said is that action has been... Yeah, but I'm saying action has been taken, but the context of your question about penalties, that is for a ruling. And I am not aware that these matters have gotten to that stage of a judicial ruling, but I am certain that there is, on the side of the administration, a resolve to have action taken against errant contractors, consultants, and supervisory firms.
Good morning. Kiana Wilbert, continues. Sir, the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights had sent some recommendations to the government to provide protection for Kaiser News staff in light of the NAMLA recording. I was just wondering if government provided the Inter-American Commission on its action or whatever steps it plans to take, and if not, do you have any intentions to respond to it?
Minister, former minister, Gil Teixeira, currently the presidential advisor on governance, he handles these matters, did indeed advise cabinet yesterday on the 9th of December that the required submission had been provided to the OAS body. I must admit the content of that submission was not a matter that was deliberated on at the level of cabinet. I think it would be a reasonable assumption that in the case of such governance matters, that indeed the presidential advisor and her actions generally are fully supported by cabinet. And no doubt the submission of the Guyana response to the ICHR took place under Ms. Teixeira's watch. And I am almost certain if it is not posted on the ICHR website soon, that the Office of the President website will soon be so doing.
The nation is saying that elections will be held sometime soon in the new year.
Mm-hmm.
As I was coming in to the building, I saw the PPP's, one of the PPP's GCOM commissioners coming to a meeting, seemed prepared, but that's my assumption. I'm just nosy. I just want to know if these meetings are part of government's plans to assess GCOM's readiness before the president gives a date, because he said it could be in his New Year's address. And I just want to know.
Well, I'm not certain what meeting you're referring to. but at least on the HPS side of the job description here, I'm not privy to those meetings. But I would say this, there is a clear understanding, and necessarily so, that the date for whether it's local government or whether it's general elections, that the date could not be recklessly set. Not that the president is so in time, but it cannot be set without the densest of collaborations with GCOM, because at the end of the day, GCOM's timetabling of the preliminary events would be what is needed to have D-Day as the real D-Day, and people don't be having oops, I need a week later or something like that. So, yes, I think the president, like all presidents before him, publicly recognized the necessity of engaging GCOM forthrightly and in a transparent way on this date to ensure that complications were never to arise with a date that heaven forbid GCOM might not be comfortable with. So whenever the president announces, you could take it for granted that that date and his announcement could only have been done after confirmation with GCOM about its readiness for D-Day for that day.
My second question, no, the question again. The president just returned from Cuba. My question is, his mode of travel, was it with regular carriers, airline carriers?
The president came back from Region 9 South, Route 9, on Saturday and left on Sunday at midnight. His traveling was facilitated by the Cuban delegation.
All right, and because I promised Erica she'll come back, this is the final question.
I wanted to know what was the status of the loan from the Exim Private Bank for the East Coast Highway Road.
What is it?
The status of the loan from Exim Bank for the East Coast Highway Road.
The status of the loan from the Exim, the Chinese Exim Bank, for the conclusion of the East Coast Road. I'm a little bit Well, let's put it this way. There isn't really much to see other than we have not executed an agreement as yet with the Chinese Exim Bank to finance that renovation, rehabilitation of the East Coast Road. I am not certain if that is what you're looking for, or if it went into greater detail, who is doing the consultations, and at what level these consultations are taking place. The government, the ambassador in Beijing, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and Ministry of Finance are all engaged with the different tiers here, locally, with the Chinese ambassador, and then through our mission with the Chinese ministry, the appropriate ministry, MOFCOM. No, no, there are two components. One had to do with the preparatory work for the Exim, the Chinese Exim loan finance rehabilitation. So the bridges, the drains, and widening, and those features that the Exim Bank loan would not attend to. The Exim Bank loan, just like the funding for the $44 million U.S. project, Green Hope to Parika, on that road, that highway, indeed has a lot to do with surfacing, developing, and putting in place on the pillings that carried out by this current wave of contract work with the five lots. That is now to put the surface, to finish the job, to get a modern highway taking you out of Georgetown.